Are you giving a talk, or you're just gonna go?
Bueno, muy bienvenidos a todos. Buenas tardes. Hoy día es un momento muy especial. Estamos dando el puntapié inicial a nuestro proyecto de filantropía. El CEP tiene una serie de trabajos que se realizan durante el año en forma permanente, como es el programa de encuestas, todas las investigaciones, etc. Y a la vez hacemos cada cierto tiempo un programa especial, y en este caso consideramos que el tema de filantropía es realmente importante en este momento en Chile. La verdad que nosotros nos conocen mucho por nuestra belleza natural y toda la variedad de nuestros ecosistemas, pero hoy día, cada vez con el cambio climático, con los problemas de sobrecalentamiento, etcétera, y la verdad que la población que está visitando los parques sin una protección como corresponde, obviamente que están trayendo un peligro importante. Las fronteras naturales nos favorecen porque la exclusividad de diversas especies en nuestro territorio es bastante única. Cerca del 25% de ellas son endémicas, y lo que nos sitúa en un lugar muy relevante a nivel mundial en la conservación de la biodiversidad. Actualmente nuestro país se encuentra dentro de un grupo de países con un alto porcentaje de áreas protegidas. Tenemos un 21% de toda nuestra área terrestre protegida y un 42% del área marítima. Sin embargo, no existe una uniformidad en la distribución de estas áreas protegidas, y el 74% de las hectáreas protegidas se encuentran ubicadas en tres regiones del extremo sur. Mientras que todos los ecosistemas de la zona central se encuentran prácticamente sin protección, sin parque, con parques declarados muchas veces, pero con ninguna protección. Tal como lo dije anteriormente, la contaminación, las visitas ya muchísimo mayor a los parques, el calentamiento, la sobreexplotación del mar y la tierra, amenazan estos frágiles ecosistemas de nuestro territorio, y por ende el CEP consideró que era muy relevante que tomáramos una posición al respecto y hiciéramos un trabajo, profundo y científico para poder contribuir al país en un tema que es muy importante hacia adelante. Actualmente, de las 1.179 especies protegidas y nativas que han sido registradas, el 66% está bajo una amenaza cierta y un 11% de ellas está en estado realmente crítico. El Estado, obviamente, que tiene sus urgencias y prioridades, y no ha reaccionado ni ha estado a la altura de este desafío importante que tenemos hoy día, y por el contrario, la sociedad civil sí ha sido un actor relevante en posicionar el cuidado al medio ambiente en la agenda política y en la conciencia ciudadana, pero enfrenta barreras que desincentivan su participación. Resulta fundamental propiciar cambios para avanzar en el cuidado de nuestro patrimonio natural. Como centro de estudio hemos querido aportar en este enorme desafío que tiene el país a través de un proyecto especial en materia de conservación, institucionalidad y filantropía ambiental. El objetivo de este proyecto es atacar los nudos críticos que hoy obstaculizan una mejor gestión del Estado y la colaboración de la sociedad civil en la conservación ambiental a través de una propuesta de políticas que permitan al país avanzar en esta tarea fundamental. La comisión que elaborará las propuestas de política pública será presidida por uno de nuestros consejeros, don Jorge Matetich, aquí presente, y será coordinada por un equipo que está compuesto por Silvia Izaguirre, Andrés Hernando, Aldo Mascareño y Nicole Grandela. Esta comisión estará compuesta por empresarios, destacados economistas y actores muy relevantes de la sociedad civil que les preocupan estos temas. Ellos son Chris Tompkins, que no necesita una presentación y que obviamente ha sido una de las grandes contribuyentes junto con su marido dentro de la filantropía en Chile, Antonio Lara, que pertenece a la Universidad Austral, Valentina Durán, de Espacio Público y Universidad de Chile, Jorge Canals, de Siglo XXI, Francisca Tondró, Eugenio Rengifo, que pertenece a la Fundación Amigo de los Parques, Bárbara Saavedra, de TNC, Elidoro Mate, aquí presente también, Alejandra Garcés, de BHP Foundation, Max Ibáñez, Alejandra Peterman, de la Fundación Willow Willow, Klaus Schmidt-Hebel, que está aquí presente, don Luis Cordero, de la UDP, la señora Alejandra Palma, de Libertad y Desarrollo, Ricardo Bossart, de WWF, Magdalena Ninat, de la Universidad Adolfo Ibáñez, Edmundo Claro, Carolina Fuensalida, Nicholas Davis. Es importante señalar de que Chile, y tal como nos señalaba en una conversación anterior Chris Thompson, gasta menos en conservación que quizás ningún país. El Estado gasta del orden de $2 anuales por hectárea. Chris nos mencionaba que en Estados Unidos son $100 por hectárea. Y países como Costa Rica gastan 16, Argentina 8, a pesar de sus problemas económicos, Uruguay y México 4. Y por ende nosotros estamos dentro de los 10 países que menos gastan en conservación de sus parques. Estamos muy desfinanciados en términos de conservación ambiental. Se estima que hay una brecha del orden de $60 millones anuales para poder llegar a tener $6 por hectárea y tener un mínimo cuidado de nuestros parques. La conservación ambiental a la vez puede ser una tremenda fuente de trabajo para las comunidades aledañas y desarrollo económico para las regiones. Es importante destacar que ya hay 3 millones de personas que están visitando parques nacionales al año en Chile y se genera, según cifras de Senatur, del orden de $1.400 millones como ingresos que van todos a regiones. Pero en algunas regiones ya incluso esto llega a un 10% del PIB regional. Es importante señalar que países como Canadá, Australia, Nueva Zelanda, Estados Unidos, el mismo Italia, tiene una fuente de ingresos enorme por el turismo en estos parques, un turismo muy sofisticado que Chile tiene todo el atractivo para traerlo, que puede generar una enorme riqueza para nuestro país y especialmente a regiones hoy día que son extremadamente pobres. La cifra puede realmente multiplicarse a una cifra inimaginable en este momento. Bueno, finalmente quiero dar las gracias, número uno, a Chris por acompañarnos nuevamente en el CEP, que tiene mucho que decirnos, enseñarnos. Ellos creo que han sido los mayores benefactores que hemos tenido en el país y ya han dado un ejemplo enorme en términos de la conservación de parques nacionales. Quiero agradecer la visita de Forrest, que está muy concentrado ahí en la traducción, a pesar de que sabe español, así que tengan cuidado. Con Forrest me une un amor por el Himalaya y por Nepal y por el Tíbet, a los dos en conjunto, pero eso es lo único que nos une, porque sus ideas van a ser muy controvertidas aquí. No, fue un gran placer tenerte aquí, Forrest, realmente, y estamos muy interesados en todo tu presentación. Quiero dar la bienvenida también a Jimena Órdenes, senadora de la República, y a don Sebastián Torrealba, diputado, y a todos los aquí presentes. Así que muchas gracias y Silvia, te dejo atentos.
Muchas gracias, bienvenidos al Centro de Estudios Públicos. Las personas que llegaron puntuales, que tomen asiento, los asientos que están vacíos, para que se puedan sentar más cómodos. Así que pasen acá adelante, hay un par de asientos para quienes estén un poco más cómodos. Vamos a premiar la puntualidad. Hemos querido iniciar este proyecto de conservación, institucionalidad y filantropía ambiental con una charla sobre la urgencia de cuidar nuestra naturaleza. Para eso hemos invitado a dos personas excepcionales en el ámbito de la filantropía y la conservación. Chris Tompkins, que no necesita introducción, ella es un referente en nuestro país en materia de conservación ambiental, especialmente de la Patagonia, y hoy va a hablar sobre la urgencia de esta tarea de proteger la naturaleza. También tenemos el honor de tener con nosotros a Forrest Berkley, gracias a la generosa colaboración de la Corporación Amigos del Parque. Forrest es un destacado filántropo norteamericano, cuyo foco ha estado en la innovación en conservación terrestre para ecosistemas en peligro de Estados Unidos, los Andes y los Himalayas. Dejo con ustedes a Chris Tompkins. Gracias.
Hey. Yeah. Hello, everybody. I'm going to speak in English because it's a lot faster and not so painful for all of you. I'm not going to speak all that long because I think tonight it's much more important to have a conversation, excuse me, with all of you about this topic that is very timely and very critical, not only in Chile, but worldwide. Excuse me. So I want to talk about the power of legacy. I want to talk about the power of a citizenry who is protecting those things they love in their own country. I come from the United States, I guess that's obvious. where one of the things I really like about our country is that philanthropy, in all its models, has been part of our culture since the early or mid 1800s. So by the time all of us come along, we're in families, whether it's $2 or it's $2 million, that the adage, the more you get, the more you give. It's simple, it's not ostentatious, it is not pulling your suspenders, but I know the power of legacy, and I know the power of thinking of civilization in its true form. What does it mean to be civil? What does it mean to have a role in your society that whatever you do with your life, you are trying to make sure to the extent that you can that the others with whom you share this, your country, are well taken care of. And of course, I really believe that includes the non-human world. They are as much a part of that as anything. So a few years ago, I visited a national park in Maine, the state of Maine, northeastern, not far from where Forrest and his family lived during the summer. And I was riding my bike carelessly, and I rode through this national park, and there were hundreds, if not thousands, of people walking their children, riding their bikes, going over roads that the Rockefeller designed for their carriages, John D. Rockefeller Jr. And I thought to myself, I'm going to go home and I'm going to write a love letter to the Rockefeller family. The couple of my generation are friends. And I did. I went home and I wrote a love letter and I said, thank you. Not just for me, but for everybody I saw that day in this national park. They don't know the history necessarily. They don't know the family who decided that, one, beauty is a value, two, protecting something for generations far forward. And I think the family was shocked to get my love letter. Actually, I don't think they ever answered. But anyway, that history, the Rockefeller family and others, really inspired Doug and me 26 years ago to start in and to see what we could do to contribute to that kind of legacy. We chose the conservation side, the environmental side, but this is applicable to anything. Over the last couple decades, we've been really fortunate to have created 13 new national parks for about just over 6 million hectares, both in Chile and Argentina. We've worked with 10 different presidents between the two countries, left, right, center. It never really mattered. And this is a big point, that philanthropy does not have to follow politics, and especially environmental philanthropy. You are, as Doug used to say, neither right nor left, but out in front. And this is really something to remember. So what happened to those Rockefeller parks? They were eventually formed into the National Park Service of the United States, and people are visiting by the millions to the places they help protect, along with other families. I have to think of my notes because I'm completely jet-lagged. So, tonight you're gathering to have a conversation about an environmental philanthropy law, which is historic in Chile. This is a huge shift, not only in how it affects your wallets and what do you do with your personal assets, but taking your responsibilities, I think, and carrying them on the wind down into Patagonia or up into the deserts in the north, and becoming responsible not only for your families and your friends and the people in your community, but expanding the idea of what is my community. You can't look at Chile today as Chile. We are way past that time. Chile holds a role, especially with the last donations that we were able to concrete last year, starting with the Bachelet government and finishing up with President Piñera. It is one of the leading countries now in terms of conservation, both terrestrial and marine. It leapt forward in terms of countries that have taken on the values of developing their economic systems, we know that, but at the same time, beginning to take very big steps into protecting the patrimony of the country itself. So, what's the reality of this now? We've made, in our case, these donations, working very closely with CONAF and the country. And the desire is there, but the infrastructure is not. Chile needs to think about itself as a role model for the world. What you do here matters, not just in Chile, but outside. I have been working with National Geographic for the last year and a half on carbon sequestration. We have all these millions of hectares, but we've never actually thought about what is our impact in terms of carbon sinks and carbon sequestration. Well, it's massive. And southern Chile has one of the richest ecosystems today in the world. And you don't think about that. That's a role that most people don't think or know that Chile plays. You have to look at yourselves now on the grand stage of global climate change. You have to look at yourselves not just what can we do internally, but what is our role, what is our responsibility globally now. Look at the fires in Brazil. Bolsonaro is very well known for developing a policy that burning a significant percentage of the Amazon basin for development is a good thing. So, not all those fires 2 weeks ago were forest. A lot of it was agriculture. But what happened? Other sovereign states began to look at Brazil and said, you cannot burn those forests. There will be economic and political consequences if this continues, because they hold two of the biggest lungs of the planet. And this is really changing the dynamics of sovereign state when it comes to ecosystems. And why I'm very happy that you're talking about this is that Chileans, generally speaking, have seen environmental philanthropy or environmental action as a direct threat to development. And sometimes it is. But the real threat is so much larger than an individual fight over a mine or an individual fight over a forest. And I think that's what's being recognized here now by the work that's being done here at SEP with Eliodoro and Jorge and many others. So, as was pointed out earlier, Chile is ranked 9th from the bottom of countries that support their conservation areas. It is spending roughly $1.50 to $2 per hectare, as you pointed out. I don't say this to criticize. I say it's an opportunity. When do you do your hardest work? When you're on the ground, when you've been knocked down. And this is a situation where there is only blue sky out ahead. And it's just a decision for all countries. Are we going to protect those places that give us eternal beauty? Are we going to protect, in this case, Chile and its ecosystems so that 200 years from now, people will be living dignified lives and healthy lives, and the non-human world as well? And these things are decisions, and the society has to make these decisions. And it seems to me that when I think back of our own experience here in Chile, how we started, how Chileans felt about conservation, at least ours, 1993 for a few years, and standing here today and getting ready to listen to how Chileans are beginning to take on their own responsibility and the change in of the value system to protect those things actively through philanthropy, encouraging philanthropy. For me, this is a story for the history books, and I think it's going to be made here in Chile. And I congratulate you all, and we'll talk a little later, but those are some thoughts anyway. I have been blessed and cursed to introduce Forrest Berkley, who is first a friend, but also a colleague in land conservation. He came out of the business world, as I did and Doug did, and has used his relatively early retirement toward protecting those places he loves. He is on various boards. He's a relentless fundraiser. He could squeeze blood out of a turnip when it comes to conservation. And he has no fear talking about the status of things openly. And I never know what he's going to say, so I'll sit down now and put my seatbelt on. And I give you Forrest Berkley.
Okay, so we're going to start with one more slide that Chris will present. So it's this one, forward.
Oh. Yes.
Oh. I don't know how many of
you have ever heard of a whack-a-mole. This is how I feel about Forrest. We have been working on a conservation funding deal for Chile, and he browbeat me to get this started with him, to support the Chilean government and all the new parks within the Patagonia region. And I would try to push him away. I'd beat him down over here, and he pops up over here, and that's why I call him my personal whack-a-mole. I don't know where he got this picture.
Terrific. Well, good evening, and thank you, especially to Chris, as well as to Amigos de los Parques and to SEP for giving me this opportunity to help make the case for the adoption in Chile of legislation to promote environmental philanthropy. My understanding is that my remarks are most of what stand between you and a pisco sour, so I'm required to at least make this provocative and entertaining to pay for the pain that you have to endure in waiting for that. As Chris mentioned, I have a background in business. I spent 25 years in the business world analyzing companies and helping my customers who were investors figure out how to maximize their economic returns. And that is the mindset that I bring to the philanthropic world. From that experience in the business world, what I saw firsthand is something that I don't think is well understood, that the human race moves forward by carefully analyzing all of the options and picking the best ones. And you know, this is the essence of capitalism, which is much maligned, but has actually produced enormous gains in the progress of humans over time. What men and women do is they search the world for the best opportunities, they seize them, and the species advances. And this process is the same whether in your family, in your business, in your government, or in your NGO. 14 years ago, I retired from full-time work, and I chose to devote my life to the NGO world. And with the same key question in mind, where are the greatest opportunities for the greatest impact to improve the world? And I chose, even before I met Chris, to focus on the environment in general and specifically on permanent land protection. Because over my lifetime, the world's great natural spaces were my greatest source of inspiration ever since my parents treated me to the wonderful national parks that we have in the United States going back over 100 years. So in my NGO journey after retirement, I have made a number of what I am told are transformational gifts for permanent land protection in the United States. But I stopped doing that several years ago in my home country because there are much better opportunities outside the United States. And I may be an American, but I am at my heart a world citizen, and I'm interested in doing the best I can wherever I can. So this is my 14th trip to Chile in 14 years. I came here once in 2006 for what I was a three-week trip where I thought I would have done Chile and I would move somewhere else on my bucket list, but I have come back every single year to Patagonia since then. And I'm here tonight to give you my perspective on the case for an environmental philanthropy law in your spectacular country. In my view, echoing what Chris said, in Chile, the need for environmental protection is far greater in the United States, and that's why I devote my time and my money here. So I will address this topic in the context of describing something that Chris mentioned, which is a promising but uncertain initiative announced 3 months ago by President Piñera. Working with international and Chilean philanthropists, the government of Chile has agreed to try, and I emphasize try, nothing is certain here, to create a sustainable governance structure and to raise the substantial funds necessary to assure permanent protection of the lands in Patagonia. One of the reasons why Patagonia is so pristine that we outside of Chile frequently forget is that Patagonia is one of the last habitable places on Earth that was substantially colonized by Europeans. And that freedom from colonization for centuries set the stage for the wonderful landscapes that you have today. So the permanent protection that this initiative is going to focus on includes not only the 400,000 hectares that my friends Chris and Doug gave, but also the 3.5 million hectares that the government added to the national parks, and in total, 11.5 million hectares of magical landscapes. And for comparison, this is about the size of Switzerland, Belgium, and the Netherlands combined. This is what you have in your backyard that isn't under threat. So let's start my presentation on a positive note by feasting our eyes on some of your new national patrimony. So how many people in this room, by a show of hands, have been to Parque Patagonia? Excellent. Excellent. It is an absolutely magical place from sunup to sunset. And more importantly, it's a fabulous place to visit. Now, if you look closely in this picture, this is the park administration or headquarters in Parque Patagonia. And if you look closely in this picture, you'll see all of the marvelous buildings there whose construction is the result of the dedication over years by Doug and Chris to this process. For those of you who haven't been there, it's a fabulous place to visit and an even more fabulous place to stay. And here, for example, here is something that you in this room own. This is the property of the government and people of Chile. This is one of the places for guests to stay at a price in Parque Nacional Patagonia. So I came here for the first time to this park. I had been to Chile starting in 2006. I came here and met Chris and Doug for the first time in 2009. And I was amazed I was just astonished by what they were doing. It was not just what they had already accomplished, but it was the audacity of what they continued to plan to do. And so I decided, even though this had nothing to do with the country that I would ever live in, that I needed to help. And so I asked Doug and Chris, you know, what do you most need that a guy like me could contribute? And what they told me was that they had a real need for funds to build a bridge within the park across the primary river, the Chacabuco River, that forms the valley that is at the heart of the park. And the purpose of this bridge is to cross this river, which is too difficult for people to wade across, to provide access to a marvelous campsite that they were going to build both for families as well as for hikers, and also to access this magnificent valley across the river called the Aviles that leads up to the historical route which was used to bring sheep from Patagonia to Lago General Carrera and then to the north. So while I was in Patagonia, and so I decided that I would consider this bridge, and while we were in discussions about this, unfortunately, my 89-year-old mother died while I was in the park, and there was no time for me to get home to see her. So I asked Chris and Doug if I could dedicate the bridge to my mother's memory, and they said absolutely. So this is the bridge. Oops, sorry, I keep hitting the wrong one. This is the bridge, and that's the Chacabuco River that it's crossing. And in the background, at the low point in the horizon, is the Aviles Valley, and you can hike from there across to the Hanimeni Preserve on a magnificent trail. And on the bridge, on the left post, which is outside of this picture, is this plaque in my mother's memory. And for people who may see this live stream who don't read English, don't read Spanish, the English translation might be, "In memory of Hannah Berkeley, 1919 to 2009, daughter of poverty, born in New York of immigrant parents who dreamed of someday owning a tree." So I gave the bridge, and that began my relationship with Doug and Chris. So about a year later, on my second trip to Patagonia, it happened at the same time that a very young, enthusiastic, and fearless a recent master's student from the Yale School of Forestry, was in Chacabuco. I still call it Chacabuco, I call it the Patagonia National Park. And she was working with Doug and Chris as a volunteer to construct a strategic plan to finish off the park so they could be prepared some years down the road for donation to your government, to your country. And she had a PowerPoint presentation in draft form, and she was asking Doug and Chris all these questions. And towards the end of our meeting, sitting around the dining table in the lodge in Chacabuco, Ms. Wu says, "Now, Doug, I've got a blank here in the presentation, because we need to put in a number to show to the donors for the amount of the endowment that we are going to raise to take care of these parks in perpetuity." And Doug said, "Endowment? There's going to be no endowment. You know, we're not going to contribute anything. Take that out." And Jude Wu said, "But wait a minute. There is no way that these parks are going to take care of themselves without financing. We have to put in something, or the donors won't believe this." And he said, no, this is a non-issue, take it out. And so I piped up and said, "Wait a minute, Doug, you can't do this. This is profoundly implausible. If you don't provide the money which donors will contribute to take care of these parks, it's going to be a disaster." And he said, "Forrest, you are the only donor who is interested in this issue." Now, I don't know how many of you met Doug, but Doug was a very strong-minded, persuasive guy who is not easily challenged. But I said, "Doug, you are dead wrong. This is the biggest single issue that keeps Forrest Berkeley from contributing as much as I'd like to contribute to the preservation of this place. It's the biggest single issue for Larry Linden. It's the biggest single issue for Kim Element. It's the biggest single issue for the World Wildlife Fund. It's the biggest single issue for every possible donor to the park." And so Doug sort of stormed out of the meeting, and Chris thanked me for bringing this up. So that was 2010. And then on that trip, I happened to, in the airport in Balmaceda, while flying back to Santiago to go home, I happened to bump into a leading Chilean industrialist. I don't see him in this room, but believe me, all or most of you would know who he is. I will not identify him to be polite. And he said to me, "Oh, isn't it amazing what Doug and Chris have done?" I said, "Oh, it's absolutely spectacular, and I'm contributing." And he said, "I can understand it." He said, "But I keep telling Doug, he's crazy to turn this over to the Chilean government. They don't have the experience, and they don't have the money to take care of this. They have got to keep this for themselves." So just store that little point. So sadly, 5 years later, on a dark day in December of 2015, Doug passed away while kayaking with some of his oldest and best friends on Lago General Carrera. I was on the phone with Chris while some of this was going on. I was in New York in a board meeting. And the movie moves on. So in late 2017, I learned from talking to Chris that the final steps were in motion, that this land and the buildings would be donated to the government with no commitments whatsoever from the government about how they were going to take care of this, what experience they would bring to bear on this huge challenge, and what money they would devote to this, to take care of the new 400,000 hectares. And so I was profoundly disappointed. I was angry. And I hope Chris will forgive me, but I have gone back to my records, and I'm going to show you some of what I said. So, to paraphrase, given what Tompkins Conservation has learned, it is clear that the government is in absolutely no position, either from an experience point of view or from a funding perspective, to take on the task of managing the 1 million acres being donated, let alone the 10 million acre expansion. Because Chris had told me about the government putting in 10 million or 9 million acres. And I said, went on to say, if Friends of Parks is launched with a traditional pay-as-you-go financing, it is headed down the dark corridor where the U.S. National Park System now finds itself with $12 billion of deferred maintenance, meaning an estimate of the money that would need to be spent today to keep the system in the United States from deteriorating further. But I continued. Without permanent financing in place, it's like now playing roulette and betting it all on red. One saving grace is that both you and I are old enough that the fatal cracks in such a system won't be apparent in our lifetimes. But if when my kids are grown up and they go to Chacabuco, they find the bridge that I gave in memory of my mother who died when I was on my first trip to meet you in 2009 in bad shape, it will have been an incredible waste. So, but there was nothing that could be done, because this is complicated, as I will explain. So, maybe a great day. January 30th, 2018, in the park, the final decrees are signed by Chris and President Bachelet. Look at all those happy faces. The reason I'm not in this picture is because I was not happy. I was having a headache. Chris is, this is great. I've got this off my plate. It's taken care of. And I'm like, oh my God, what are we going to do? So, among the other thoughts that were going through my head was my sympathy for Knauf. You know, adding the Tompkins donation and the government's transfer to the national park, suddenly, Knauf has new unfunded responsibilities on 4 million additional hectares, and in a sense, it's like the challenge of integrating West and East Germany when the Berlin Wall comes down. So what I'd like to do in order to sort of think about how we move forward from here is to give you another example, to talk about another major gift to a country that came from foreigners that became a national park, and I suspect that many of you will recognize this. This in the harbor of New York City is the Statue of Liberty, which is part of a national monument. And it was given by the country of France to the United States in 1875. And between the time when Ellis Island nearby became the main port for immigration into the United States, and in 1892 and 1954, when Ellis Island closed, 12 million immigrants came past the Statue of Liberty, this inspirational statue, into the United States. And every one of those immigrants, by U.S. law, had to have a medical exam at the immigration hospital at Ellis Island. And one of those immigrants was my grandmother, who came from Czechoslovakia to the United States in 1910, the oldest of 13 children. This is a woman who never learned to read or write. And she was examined at this hospital, which is today part of one of our finest national parks. And this is a recent picture of that hospital that she was examined in. So in the United States, which many people in Chile idolize and like to look up to, this is an example of what not funding your national parks get you to. Now, my grandmother could not read or write, but she was one tough cookie, and she is up there in heaven, I hope, shaking her fist at me and saying, "Forrest, how can you allow this to happen?" So let's come back closer to home for you, to Chile. So I mentioned that my first trip here was almost 14 years ago, and the highlight of that trip was going to Torres del Paine, and the highlight of that time was a 7-day trek on the W and related trails. And during that time, I went on a 12-hour day trip from a place called Refugio de los Cuernos up into a place called the French Valley, which is a side trip off the W trek, up to the snow line in January. I filled my water bottle with snow. I put a sock around it. I brought it back to Refugio de los Cuernos. And for the first time in history, chilled white wine was served at Refugio de los Cuernos. And I've had the luxury in my lifetime, especially post-retirement, of traveling in many of the world's most magnificent mountain ranges, including the Himalayas. And for me, on a sunny day, what you have in your country in the French Valley is one of the 10 most beautiful places that I have been to on Earth. So I loved it so much on that first trip that I made a special trip back there 3 years later to bring my teenage son to enjoy this place. And then, this past January, I went back. So I planned this trip to Torres del Paine, and I scheduled 5 days, hoping for just, 5 days I should get one sunny day out of Patagonia in January, but no. So it just rained, chubascos, viento, the whole shtick went on. So I hung out in Puerto Natales for 5 days, drinking coffee and mate and surfing the internet, trying to change my plane flights for that sold out, 3 times per week flight from Puerto Natales to Santiago. Finally, the weather improved. So I drove back. I drove up to the park. I got on the last barcaza across Lago Peowe. I went to Refugio de los Cuernos. I set up my tent. I set my alarm clock for 5 a.m. I got up. I heated up my coffee, my oatmeal. I started out at 5:30 before the sun came up, and then things went wrong. So the first thing that went wrong was this. So this is one of my favorite pairs of hiking boots, and I had just had it a new set of soles put on the hiking boots by the most highly reputed sole resoler in the United States. And on day 6 in Patagonia, it fell apart. But I found, I don't get mad, I get even. I have found an abandoned bridge, and I stole this piece of baling wire. We call it baling wire that you see wrapped around. And then I found a group of German trekkers, and I managed to talk them into giving me some of this what we call duct tape to wrap around the toes so that I could do the whole day. And I made it up into the park, and here is your French Valley on a sunny day. On my third trip there, maybe the last of my lifetime, an absolutely magnificent place, the highlight of my trip. So feeling great, I went back. At the end of the 12 hours, I just barely caught the last barcaza, went across the lake, collapsed somewhere, and then continued my trip. And the next day, I thought, I want to go back to the Torres themselves, to the Mirador de los Torres de Paine, for those of you who've been there. The last time I had been there was on my first trip in 2006. And I thought, I have a couple of extra days. I ought to go. And this is what I found. So this is the trail to the named iconic peaks, the Torres del Paine, of the crown jewel of the Chilean National Park System. This is one part of the trail. This is another. and this is another. This is a national disgrace, that this was allowed to happen and that I allowed this to happen. I was there 13 years earlier and didn't see this coming, that many of you in this room went back and saw this. This is, for my money, I'm sorry as a foreigner to say this, this is a national disgrace. So, you know, what we need to do is say, you know, how did this happen? And in essence, you know, there's a great line from, there's an organization called the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. And the fellow who is the director of it about 15 years ago was once giving a speech, and he said, and I quote, "A lot of talk about conservation without enough money to get it done is just a lot of conversation." This is about money and experience and national willpower. And so as has been mentioned today, we've had studies done by outside consultants about how Chile spends on its hectares of preserved land relative to other countries. Those are the bars over on the right. So the top line is Chile, which spends about $1.50 per hectare. Across the border in Argentina, your neighbor, which continues to be the economic basket case of the 21st century, they are spending 15 times as much. What is going on here? Okay, and it's far greater in New Zealand and South Africa in the United States. So, you know, we have an American expression for what's going on here. And we call it kicking the can down the road. And so what we have here, if you'll pardon me, is, you know, what we are all doing is we are taking useless discarded cans and we're saying, ugh, you know, with problems like that, you know, we cannot deal with it. So just, we don't want to say, just kick it out of the way. Kick the problem down the road, and somebody else, the next legislature, the next president, the next populace, you know, our grandchildren will have to deal with it. And I am here to say it is time to stop kicking the can down the road. So the initiative that was announced recently by President Piñera can be one piece of the solution. We call this a PFP, which stands for Project Finance for Permanence, or in Espanol, Proyecto de Financiamiento para la Permanencia. And in summary, what we've done is we've created an ambitious coalition, including Tompkins Conservation, the Pew Charitable Trust from the United States, Balloon Latam, and the government of Chile. And the structure has yet to be finalized, but it might look something like this. The idea is that individual philanthropists and foundations, both from overseas and from within Chile, including people in this audience, I hope, will raise a conservation transition fund, something in the range of $65 to $85 million. And payments from this fund will be contingently available over the next 15 to 20 years to help the government of Chile grow its capacity to manage this historic challenge, to properly care in perpetuity for the 11.5 million hectares in all of the national parks in Patagonia. So this is a very tasty carrot, $65 to $85 million in the payments from it. You know, una zanahoria sabrosa. But there's also a stick, a palo. And to receive payments from this fund, what is being considered is something that has been used before in other countries like Costa Rica. Namely, the government has to deliver, principally in two areas. Number one, what the government needs to do is to improve park revenues, and through other transfers, the government needs to grow its financial contributions to park operations to get us from $1.50 towards something much more reasonable. And secondly, perhaps more importantly, there should be a set of environmental, financial, and operating standards to be agreed in advance of the closing of the deal. And the operations of the national parks will need to satisfy these standards on an ongoing basis in order to receive ongoing payments from the Conservation Transition Fund. So, needless to say, this is very complicated. It's been done before, but maybe this one in Chile may be the most complicated one that's ever been done. There's a mountain of details. We need to raise the $65 to $85 million. We need to figure out how to engage the local communities who are adjacent to the parks to help them support this process. So I fully accept the blame for causing all these complications, because I was the person who browbeat, to use her term, Chris Tompkins, into supporting this initiative to secure her legacy and Doug's legacy. And I was the first person to commit to make a major philanthropic contribution to this initiative. And why did I do this? Well, I did this for a couple of reasons. First, because under US tax law, I can deduct my contribution from the income on which I have to pay taxes. But more importantly, I want this project to succeed in this country, which has so much to offer in the natural world and so much to lose. I want this initiative to succeed so that Chile can be known as the shining light of the world of land conservation, driven by philanthropy that delivers results, La Estrella de Chile, so that all of Chris and Doug's 30 years of hard work will be rewarded. Now, as promising as the PFP is, and I emphasize promising, it's not a done deal, it's not clear that it will happen. It needs everyone's help. But as promising as it is, the adoption of a general law that promotes environmental philanthropy will, over the long term, deliver even greater impact throughout your entire country. And environmental philanthropy can be an example of one of the highest return on investment steps that the government can ever take. So, for example, if the legislature were to decide on a system which is similar to that of the US or Canada, Chilean philanthropists would get to deduct against their taxable income the amount of their contribution. So if someone in the room wants to give a $1 million contribution, it would reduce their taxable income by that amount. And assuming that the top marginal tax rate is 35%, the net cost of the government is only $350,000 to deliver a $1 million benefit to the environment that the government will otherwise have to do. So in other words, unless you believe that the government is three times as effective as the private sector at identifying where the nation's needs are the greatest, then this is a profitable government program. In addition, my understanding is that the government each year transfers about $1.5 billion of payments to the Patagonia region to improve over time the local economic conditions. And a well-organized program of environmental philanthropy that maintains the landscape while promoting local economics could be one ingredient in reducing that annual enormous national financial burden. So to return to where I began my remarks, every Chilean citizen, whether working in business, in an NGO, or in the government, is engaged in the same long-term enterprise for the improvement of the individual good as well as the overall good of this amazing country. That is, to choose among options to maximize returns that add up to the overall return of the country. This challenge is for you, and environmental philanthropy law can be a key ingredient of that bright future, and I very much look forward to its enactment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Forrest. Vamos a dar la palabra, vamos a recoger algunas preguntas del público, así que levanten la mano si quieren hacer preguntas a los panelistas. Tenemos una pregunta acá. ¿Alguien más que quiera?
Buenas tardes. Mi pregunta va con una breve introducción. El Estado de Chile hoy día no tiene la estructura política de garantizar la conservación y preservación de estos territorios. No es solamente un tema de infraestructura y presupuesto, es un tema de qué forma CONAF o Ministerio de Agricultura o quien sea administra estos bienes y garantiza la preservación y conservación. Entonces no es un tema solamente de presupuesto e infraestructura. Y ahí la pregunta es, ¿de qué modo se puede influenciar la agenda pública para que haga una reforma de CONAF o de quien sea para garantizar la conservación? Porque si no, esto no va a ocurrir. Uh-huh. Si es que no se crea esa institucionalidad.
muchas gracias. ¿Alguna otra pregunta?
Es cuáles son los principales impedimentos que se ven para que exista hoy día en Chile una ley de filantropía ambiental.
Gracias. Y una tercera pregunta acá. La cuarta. Pedro, a la señora en la tercera fila.
Yo quiero preguntar ¿qué tiene el gobierno para la educación en general de la ciudadanía para el cuidado de los parques?
Gracias. Acuérdense que nuestros invitados son internacionales. y una.
What programs of education and environment have the government in Chile?
Oh, yeah. Y al.
Klaus Schmidt-Hebel. First, congrats and a big. Big thanks to both Chris and Forrest. I have one question for Forrest, which is the following. You mentioned that this was difficult, setting up this fund and the donation, and then getting the government to agree, and that you had some experiences with other countries doing this. Could you tell us about these other countries and which were the biggest challenges, Costa Rica or South Africa or Himalaya, whatever?
There aren't many PFP projects in the world. I think there are 7 now. Costa Rica, Bhutan came online about 4 months ago. Colombia is quite new. Peru, a very big project in the Amazon in Brazil, 23 million hectares, I think. The fund was $220 million.
Canada.
I didn't know about Canada. Anyway, this idea was largely started by a friend by the name of Larry Linden, who was a senior partner at Goldman for many years, and he, like Forrest, really thought about the hard, cold possibilities for funding and protecting wildlands permanently. And the Costa Rican deal is much different than the rest. It's an endowment. $50 million was raised from the private sector, and the Costa Rican government agreed to put this into perpetuity, and they put a lot of money in a fund that's revolving. Each one of these projects has had its own particularities, depending on the country and so on. The one that we are working on here in Chile is quite new because it does, as Forrest mentioned, have a community component to it. Because I think all of us who work in conservation, especially large-scale conservation, believe that if you don't have neighboring communities in not only engaged in but benefiting from the national parks that are next door to them, you can't imagine that 100 to 200 years from now those parks will be well protected. As a lot of people say, the local communities are really the best park guards you can ever imagine. There are lots of circumstances where national parks are they're a global brand, and they are true drivers of local economies. So anyway, this mechanism for Chile is a first. I'd like to address your question, and I'm going to speak in English. I think you have to look. Your question was, Why can't CONAF or protected areas in Chile get more support from society, or how do you build that support?
And those, it's a simple question, but it has very complex answers, because it, you have to start with the ethos of the country itself. A government, let's say Chile, you have to look at national parks today as a cold, hard asset of the country. It's like copper in the ground or fish in the sea. National parks drive more tourism than any other mechanism in the world over a long period of time. So as a country like Chile is looking for the diversification of its economic development and so on, the ministers of that are driving economies in a country, they need to look at the national park system and a well-managed national park system as an investment, as an asset. So that's one thing. You have to change the notion. It's not just because they're fabulous. It's because they really do function. They change an economic model, not only at a regional level, local level, but at a national level, because you are talking about global markets when it comes to national parks. It's the best brand other than Marlboro and Coca-Cola. We have worked a lot in terms of how do you help a company, a society, to begin to recognize the value, intrinsic and economic, for their national parks. The creation of Amigos de los Parques, which is growing very fast now, connecting Chileans very physically to their national parks, but also the value that the national parks in this country belong to all of you. I walk into Yellowstone National Park, I think, this is my park. Somebody threatens that park, you have to answer to me and 310 million other Americans. And that's the ethos. That is the bridge that has to be crossed. And this, again, to confirm, I think, what Forrest said, the environmental philanthropy law goes a long way in inviting, celebrating Chileans of all walks of life to invest in their own national parks, to support them, to become them. And it's a process, but Chile has definitely, definitely come a long way. So you're going to get there.
Forrest, you want to answer some of the questions?
We're covering so much.
What are the impediments to this creating a law like this? I think that's the question.
Well, I don't know the local political environment here, so I'm not in a particularly good position to answer to it. But I think that, based on, you know, conversations, discussions that I've been in the United States, if I could form some analogies, government doesn't like losing tax revenue, and so they're resistant to giving additional tax breaks, that being said. So there's the economic basis, number one. In this case, given that the government fully recognizes that it's got this problem, it should be doing whatever it can. It should be begging people to help it get out of the bind by contributing to this, because the more that Chilean philanthropists contribute to things like the PFP or otherwise helping out the parks, perhaps parks in other parts of the country, the less is the burden for the government. And the government gets a 3 times return on its money. If a Chilean philanthropist puts $1 million into a park in the north part of Chile, the government has to put in, you know, it costs the government $350,000, and the government has to put in, you know, $1 million less, so it's a huge return. So that is not widely understood. There's also the issue of, you know, who should be making decisions about how the national treasure is spent? You know, and there's been a general objection in the United States of, you know, why are private individuals being allowed to do this? And, you know, what I like to point out is, you know, the fact that an individual gift may not produce a great result, an individual charitable gift, should be offset against the fact that there are lots of programs that the government produces that produce nothing. So if you think about the problem in aggregate as opposed to at an individual basis, and you basically say, look, because it's three times leveraged, unless you believe that the government is three times as effective, and, you know, I have no complaint with people who work in government. Many of my relatives have worked in government over time. But, you know, I am not three times smarter than anyone in this room, and there's no one in this room who is three times smarter than me. The differences are minor. And the math of the situation that the government gets a three times return for allowing this to happen should overwhelm any objections to allowing tax deductions for philanthropy.
Tomamos dos preguntas más.
I find that your explanation, I find it very interesting. But
your explanation is very interesting, and I'm convinced that you can get the fundings in Chile. The problem we have as Chileans is, who the hell will they manage that? If I make a proposition, this must be in both hands, private and the government, on equal terms. Otherwise, people would not spend the money because they don't know where it will go to. Unfortunately, the history of CONAF is not very positive in that respect. And because they didn't have the funds for it. It's not because they are not capable or they are too few. Probably they are not well paid for what you need.
Gracias. Y Francisca?
May I just say something about CONAF?
Yes.
Oh. I agree with you. Last 26 years, as we said, anything we work on in conservation, we're going to donate to the Chilean or the Argentine government. And of course, it's CONAF, 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 CONAF over the two decades. And I always say the same thing. You focus on CONAF, you are blind to the actual problem. CONAF is way down there at the end of the tail of a process that is a... It's not CONAF. It starts with leadership. It starts with governmental leadership. It starts with citizenry asking for a world-class national park system that is well cared for and well funded. It has been a tremendous injustice to CONAF, and there's no training school for people who work in national parks. There's no infrastructure. So I hope that we can stop talking about CONAF and talking about what are the root causes of the national park system and values in any country, but specifically now, tonight.
We could just say that. So just to echo Chris's comments, one of the goals of the PFP is to address the concern that you raise, which I have as well, which is how can a person who's being asked to donate to this process have some assurance that the money will actually be well spent and the process will be well managed? And the key to that is to not make this open-ended philanthropy. The key is not to just hand the government and say, go at it, do what you want. The key instead is to have standards. And so part of the process will be looking at each preserved area and working with CONAF and saying, what do you need to do to get from here to there? And how can we judge you? What will be the elements of a report card with environmental standards, with science standards, with financial standards, for whether or not you're doing a good job. And so that is a way of holding the feet to the fire, as we say in American, of the people who are actually spending the money to make sure they spend it well. Because if they don't, the way the PFP process works is they don't get their allocation until they clean up their act. And that is not very common in US philanthropy. This is very unusual. But it's a way of, in essence, trying to bring business practices to bear to improve government. And frankly, I think the CONAF people, once they realize that they have the funding and they have the leadership and they have the support of a process and they're in this with people who have their backs in mind, it could usher in a whole new period where the management of the parks gets immensely better and the management is completely different from what we see today.
La última pregunta, Francisca.
Okay, well, thank you, Forrest and Chris, for this so inspirational presentation. I'm Francisca from TNC, and well, we know very well how hard it is to battle in raising funds for conservation. And one of the issues you said, Chris, is related to tourism, sustainable tourism, and that is, I want to know your opinion, how you face it, because it's a dilemma, you know. You want to do conservation, you want to do science, and you have also this opportunity. It's an economic opportunity, but on the other hand, it's a big risk also. We are facing in La Reserva de Valdivia, we're facing all the risk of fires, of campers, of people, you know, constructing. It's also an important source of request of funds to be patrolling. So that is a dilemma. I want to know your opinion there. And also, something that we have been also thinking about is the legacy programs. We know that in the USA, legacy exists, you know, and we are far, far away from that in Chile. And how do you think, Forrest and Chris, how do you think we could do that here in Chile? You know, think of, you know, how our money, how our resources will, you know, we can give them back when we pass away. How do you think that in the fund you are creating?
I'll talk about tourism, and I'll leave the second question for Forrest. Look, I'm not a big fan of tourism. You know, I'm not in the tourism trade. But I do know this. There are a lot of models, and there are a lot of things that can go wrong. And we all know that. With anything in life, there are risks. So, Does anybody in the south of Chile look forward to industrial tourism? Of course not. But here's the thing. We're very involved in rewilding, especially in which is our largest project in northeastern Argentina. We're reintroducing jaguars and 10 other species. And what's happening there? And what's happening outside of Paine? Wildlife. Besides beauty, scenery, wildlife is starting to come back in a healthy way, maybe even a permanent way, because of tourism. And if you want to think about a process that really is evolved, think of Botswana, think of Kenya, think of Tanzania, you name it. So, how tourism is developed, and we're talking about South Chile now, that's up to the regions. I know, I've worked a long time in Palena, Aysén. They care about how this develops, especially Aysén. This has been a conversation that's gone on for 25 years. But ultimately, regional areas have to decide their own destinies. But I can say that when you take nature, restore it, bring back wildlife, or just form a truce with the wildlife that is there, that helps stabilize economic activity in rural areas. and it's happened in Argentina. It's happening all over the world. So if you don't want industrial tourism, like any other industry that may or may not come into your area, then you have to get out of bed every day and fight against it and work with political leadership, work with the entities that can make these long-term decisions that are really ordering the territory. That's what you're talking about. You have to have a vision about your place. You have to have a vision about your region. You have to have a vision about your country. And then you have to get up and fight for it over and over and over again. So that's a choice. But I can tell you from a landscape and wildlife perspective, that is a great combination for stabilizing development in areas that may have trouble finding other means to diversify their economic activity.
So, as I understand your legacy question, the question is how to, over time, move Chilean society so it thinks about using philanthropy to cement its legacy? Is that the essence of your question?
You die, it's in your will.
Let's cut to the chase.
Sorry, so I'm not following.
Well, I'm not sure I do either, but what is the role of philanthropy in your will and testaments? Is that a big part of giving? Yes.
How can we also do it in Chile, you know, because that is something that we don't use here in Chile.
I think it's a great question for CEP and Chileans. Foreigners can't answer that question for you. But if you depending on how serious you are about it, then you can go get those answers.
I mean, it is worth pointing out that part of the reason that philanthropy in the United States is such a big deal, it's a bigger percentage of GDP in the United States than any other developed country, is because of the tax benefits. And if the government is nervous about making these tax benefits permanent, it could, you know, offer a 10-year period of time. Say, we'll allow this for 10 years and see how it goes. And then we'll have a report that analyzes what was the money given to and what did it do. And, you know, but the important thing is that it has to focus on it in aggregate, because there are going to be certain philanthropic gifts that are given that are absolutely loony. And if the government complains about that, you should say, oh, well, let's hold them up against the lens of whether all the government spending itself was sensible. And given that, if the tax benefit is just on the marginal rate that you would pay, again, unless the government is three times as effective, it is a great thing for the government to promote. So trying it in certain issue areas for a limited period of time, or even make a dollar limit. You know, if it's worried that it will open the floodgates, say, we'll allow the first, you know, X hundreds of millions in this issue area for these years. And then, you know, without revealing who gave what necessarily, have an analysis of where the money went so that people can actually debate this, can discuss this with real data, with real live experience.
Muchas gracias, Chris. Muchas gracias, Forrest.
Thank you.
Démosle un aplauso. Antes de finalizar, le quiero dar la palabra a Jorge Matetich, quien es la persona que va a presidir la comisión del proyecto especial del CEP sobre conservación ambiental.
Primero que nada, muchas gracias, Cris.
Aló. ¿Aló? Ahora sí.
Muchas gracias, Chris y Forrest, por esta gran charla que nos han dado. Creo que en forma muy entretenida nos han presentado un problema que es muy serio. Chile tenemos un patrimonio increíble, que no lo tenemos muy valorado los chilenos, gastamos muy poco en tratar de mantenerlo. Es una riqueza que en algún momento puede ser tanto más importante como lo que es el cobre, o lo que es la pesca, o lo que es la parte forestal hoy día. Y lo que queremos en el CEP justamente es generar aquí un encuentro en que podamos con todos los sectores interesados desarrollar primero que nada una institucionalidad en que se pueda hacer aportes del sector privado a esto. Queremos también que se cree una institucionalidad que administre esto en forma que dé garantías de profesionalismo y de calidad en el tiempo. Claramente, el administrar recursos y el generar una política sostenible, que estos parques, que son una maravilla a nivel mundial, puedan realmente mantenerse a una escala que generen un interés mundial para Chile como un centro que puede ser con un turismo focalizado, ¿no es cierto?, que puede generar mucha riqueza a las comunidades que están ligadas a esto y al país también. Así que tenemos un tremendo desafío. Queremos abrir aquí la discusión en el CEP a todos los que estén realmente interesados en esto y sobre todo queremos levantar la conciencia de todos los chilenos que esta es una tarea de todos y no solamente de los que algunos que donen o de las instituciones. Así que creo que el trabajo es tremendo. Creo que el ejemplo con que Chris y Forrest han predicado y han hecho esto tienen el valor moral de realmente ser autoridades reconocidas a nivel mundial en esto, en lo que estamos doblemente agradecidos. Y por último, agradecerle a todos ustedes que realmente ha habido hoy día una presencia increíble. Creemos que esto es un buen sinónimo, un buen augurio de que vamos a tener un trabajo productivo en esto. Y ideal es que sean miles y millones los chilenos que de alguna manera valoren lo que tenemos en Chile y que lo tratemos como se merece, como realmente un tesoro nacional. Así que muchas gracias. Tenemos esta tarde un pequeño cóctel en el primer piso a lo que están todos cordialmente invitados. Muchas gracias.